Hi everyone, we're back again with another antibiotic in our pharmacology series. And today we're going to be speaking about the cephalosporins. So before we get started, we'll start with our medical disclaimer. You can actually pause the video and read it. We usually put the disclaimer up because as nurses and nurses to be, safety is always a priority. So cephalosporins are antibiotics that treat gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria. They're considered to be broad-spectrum antibiotics. And the way they work is that they bind to the bacterial cell wall and it causes the cell that has the bacteria in it to die. Because cephalosporins are broad spectrum, they are used to treat a variety of different infections. So we have pneumonia, urinary tract infection, it's used for tonsillitis, it's used for gonorrhea. It's used to treat a broad array of illnesses, infections. So, one of the easiest ways to identify a cephalosporin is to actually look at the prefix of the name. And you would see with cephalosporins, they all start with ceph, C-E-F or C-E-P-H. So you have cephdinir, cephaloxin, ceftriaxone, cefazolin. So they have the ceph beginning to their name. And that's like a little memory tip for you because the cephalosporins starts with the ceph sound. All right. So cephalosporins can be given by the intravenous or IV route, intramuscular or IM route, or oral. And you will see that written as PO, because we still use some Latin terms in our everyday medical language, and PO simply means per os, by mouth. The side effects of cephalosporin, I have a little memory tip here for you, and it's hairy, H-A-I-R-Y. Hairy. And so we're going to start with hyperglycemia. Yes, hyperglycemia. Cephalosporins can increase your blood sugar level. Allergic reactions. One of the big testing area with particularly cephalosporins and another class of antibiotic that we will discuss in another video, it's allergic reactions. And allergic reactions can be mild or they can be severe and life-threatening, right? So it can really, it can go from something mild, you know, like a small rash, all the way up to laryngeal edema and close up your airway, which is definitely life-threatening. Insufficient platelets. Did you know cephalosporin cause bone marrow suppression? Yes, yes. So that leaves your clients at risk for blood clots, okay? And previously I told you that cephalosporins can be given by the IV route. It can be given intravenously. So you have to monitor your client's IV site, right? because, you know, the client is at risk for blood clots, renal problems. Cephalosporin is excreted through the urine. So it can be heavy, it can be hard on your kidneys to get rid of cephalosporins. How do we monitor your patient's renal function? What are the two labs that we would look at? What labs would we look at to monitor your client's renal function? Yes, yes, you're right. The BUN and creatinine. Yes, those are two labs that we would look at. Yellow poop, diarrhea. A side effect of the cephalosporins are diarrhea. And the cephalosporins are known for causing a special type of diarrhea called C. diff diarrhea, Clostridium difficile diarrhea. So we have to monitor our patients for changes in their bowel movements and diarrhea, if they're having diarrhea. Something that I need to bring your attention to, and this is not unique to cephalosporins, this is for all medication, GI disturbances. Any medication that is taken by the oral root, because it has to go through your gastrointestinal system, your patient will experience some form of GI disturbance. And the GI disturbance can be nausea, vomiting, it can be diarrhea, it can be anorexia. There are some medications that actually leave like a metallic taste in your mouth. You have a funny taste in your mouth. There's some diarrhea some medications that cause constipation. So any medication that you take by the oral route has the ability to cause some sort of GI disturbance. And that's a good memory tip for you to remember for all oral antibiotics. Some special considerations with cephalosporins. Before you start any antibiotic treatment, the doctor is going to order a culture and sensitivity test for your client. And we do this test before your client starts their antibiotic therapy. So usually they would order the test, and the doctor typically would have you start a broad spectrum antibiotic before the results come back. And we do this because we want to get your client starting to feel better. We want to get this bacteria that's making the person sick out of them. And then after they get the results from the culture and sensitivity, the doctor may actually change from a broad spectrum antibiotic to a more specific antibiotic depending on the bacteria that shows up in the culture and sensitivity. We need to ask our client about allergy history. Even if there's allergy history in the chart, or you might have asked the client before, maybe earlier in your shift, you will go back and you will double check allergy history. And the reason why we do that is because there is a cross allergy between cephalosporins and penicillin. So we really want to check with our client regarding any history of penicillin allergy. Because if the person has an allergy to penicillin, they're also going to have an allergy to cephalosporins because, you know, of the cross allergy between them, right? And a good memory tip for that is that we don't give the cillins the cephs, we don't give the cephs with the cillins. Okay, so that's just a little memory tip. So now let's say you give your patient a dose of their cephalosporin and then they're having an allergic reaction. What would you do? Do you know what to do? Well, what you would do is you would hold and you would stop and hold the medication. Right? And then the next thing that you're going to do, you're going to assess your patient to see exactly what their allergic reaction is. Right? So your assessment, you know, may involve you inspecting them. You may have to auscultate the lungs because you want to know if this is affecting the person's respiratory status. You have to see if your client is declining. And then if they're having a really severe allergic reaction, the antidote that we're going to use is epinephrine, right? The antidote for the allergic reaction, you know, is epinephrine, right? Cephalosporins are one of the classes of antibiotics that should be taken with food. Because if you take your cephalosporin on an empty stomach, it's going to decrease the effectiveness of the medication. So your client would not experience the maximum benefit of the medication if they take it on an empty stomach. We do not want our clients consuming alcohol while they're taking cephalosporins because it causes a disulfiram-like reaction in the client. And that is not a very pleasant feeling. They will have, you know, it may present as headache, muscle cramps, dizziness, vomiting. So we also want to question our clients also about their alcohol consumption. Because let's say your client came through the emergency room and they're intoxicated. We would want to make sure that we're not going to give them a cephalosporin because we're going to get this disulfiram-like reaction and the doctor would have to order a different class of medication for your client. We do not want to give cephalosporins to clients with renal impairment because cephalosporins is excreted through our urine. So if the person has kidneys that are impaired, we don't want to add cephalosporin to this because it's going to make their kidney function even worse. So we would not give it to someone that has problems with their kidneys. We do not want to administer cephalosporin together with calcium-containing products because this can also decrease the effectiveness of the medication. We want to teach our client to take the entire course of their medication regimen, even if they are feeling better. And the reason we would want to do this is because the medication killed off some of the bacteria, but definitely not all. So what happens, the bacteria gets smarter than the medication, and the bacteria becomes resistant, and the medication, the antibiotic, does not work anymore, right? So then your client will then have to get a different treatment, a different class of antibiotics to treat the infection that they have. And we definitely don't want that. We have to teach our clients, especially our diabetic clients, that cephalosporin can cause hyperglycemia and false urine glucose tests. So we want to let our diabetic client know that they may need to monitor their blood sugar a little more frequent while they're on their course of cephalosporins. We also want to teach clients that cephalosporins can cause false positive opioid tests, so that way they don't get alarmed if something like that is to occur. We also want to teach our client to watch out for the following signs and symptoms. There's like furry overgrowth on the tongue, diarrhea that has pus or bloody, if they're having vaginal itching, because all of those are signs of a super infection. And we don't want our clients at home trying to treat this super infection that may be developing while they're on their current antibiotics. Remember earlier in the previous slide, I told you that cephalosporin cause C. diff diarrhea, and your client would have to get an additional treatment if they develop this form of diarrhea. So that's all our notes that we have for cephalosporins. We'll be back with another class of antibiotics in the series. And until then, take care, be well, goodbye.